Current estimates from the CDC report that 1 out of 5 adults who had COVID developed long COVID. Long COVID is an umbrella term for the long-lasting mental and physical health problems after COVID-19 infection. The list of symptoms is extensive, and one of the most common cluster of symptoms are neurological. Neurological symptoms can range from brain fog and chronic fatigue to sleep mood or smell disorders, and many more. Many of these neurological disorders can be debilitating to the point that it is hard to focus on work. One study following more than 3,000 long haulers found that nearly half of them had not returned to full employment for 6 months. As for how long these neurological symptoms last, we cannot tell with certainty yet, but there is this small study following 52 long haulers that found most neurological symptoms persisted 15 months after the onset. The silver lining is that patients reported improvement in their recovery. It just seems to be a slow recovery process. The symptoms that did not decrease in frequency included brain fog, headaches, numbness, blurred vision, tinnitus, fatigue, depression, anxiety, and insomnia. There was a decrease in patients with anosmia and dysgeusia, so patients were recovering their sense of smell and taste. At the beginning of the pandemic, when people continued experiencing neurological symptoms after recovering from COVID-19, my first thought was, okay, we know from autopsy studies that people passing away from COVID-19 had brain regions damaged because of oxygen starvation and strokes. And well, recovering from brain damage is no walk in the park. It is often a slow process, and that is why symptoms persist long after the virus has been eliminated. But as more studies pile up, we're finding even more mechanisms by which long COVID symptoms develop, even when the virus is not present anymore. For example, one study exposed SARS-CoV-2 virus to hamsters via their nostrils. 31 days after the hamsters had been infected, they were sacrificed to examine the extent of the damage the virus had caused and find any unique characteristics, any biological change that could contribute to the prolonged and persistent symptoms seen in long haulers. What they found when looking at the neuroepithelial lining in our nose and the nerves and circuitry connected to it was unexpected. Long after the virus was eliminated, or at least not at detectable levels, they found that the lining in the nostrils and the olfactory bulb, a brain region involved in processing smell, still had high levels of inflammation. This is unusual, and it's indicative of an ongoing immune response. In these regions, you could find activated microglia, which are the immune cells of the brain. Cells that engulf viruses and other pathogens called macrophages were also found in the brain. And there was an interferon and chemokine response, which are all signs of inflammation and your immune system fighting something. Chronic inflammation within the olfactory bulb can affect sensory, emotional, and cognitive processes. The hamsters showed signs of anxiety, and preclinical studies have linked damage to the olfactory bulb with depression. The olfactory bulb and the olfactory epithelium from human donors were also examined to verify these results. Both the olfactory bulb and the olfactory epithelium showed signs of inflammation in people that had recovered from COVID-19, but passed away from other causes. I find it quite interesting that inflammation continues long after COVID has been cleared. There are several hypotheses on why this is still happening. One potential reason is that there are still truncated parts of the SARS-CoV-2 virus floating around and inducing an immune response. Another possibility is that the damage in the olfactory epithelium makes it easier for bacteria to infiltrate the brain, which would also initiate an immune response. And finally, it could also be that the methods used simply did not detect SARS-CoV-2, which would still be present in the brain. Brain damage because of oxygen starvation, strokes, and prolonged neural inflammation are not the only potential mechanisms causing neurological disorders. And COVID-19 infection has many ways of damaging the brain. Patients experiencing brain fog and anosmia show brain regions with a decrease in metabolic rate, something known as hypometabolism. Inflammation of the trigeminal nerve has been associated with headaches and general pain, and impairing of the GABAergic intracortical circuits has been linked to fatigue. And last but not least, we have autoimmune diseases, for which I'll be creating a video just to discuss this topic. But just as an example, antibodies produced to fight the SARS-CoV-2 virus have been found to mistakenly target endothelial cells. Endothelial cells form part of the blood-brain barrier, and when the connection between them is disrupted, harmful chemicals leak into the brain. This leakage will induce an immune response and inflammation in the brain, and neurons will be damaged. At the same time, these endothelial cells are activated and cause platelets to stick together. Clots form, and this increases the risk of strokes. A therapy to prevent these antibodies from sticking to the endothelial cells might help protect the brain. The impact of SARS-CoV-2 infection on the brain doesn't necessarily appear a few weeks or months later. A recent study looked at the healthcare records of 1.2 million people that had COVID-19 and compared them with a control group who had other respiratory infections. What they wanted to find from this group of people is how long after getting COVID, the risk for developing neurological or psychiatric disorders goes back to the baseline. In other words, when can someone that had an infection feel safe that they will not develop a neurological disorder because of the infection? The good news is anxiety disorder symptoms and depression risk goes down to the control group level in 2 months. Brain fog, dementia, seizures, and psychotic disorders remain higher than the control group even after 2 years. Dementia especially impacts people age 65 and over. 4.5% of this age group develop dementia compared with 3.3% of the control group. For people in the 18 to 64 years old range, brain fog affected 6.4% of people who had COVID compared to 5.5% of the control group. And children had an increased risk of developing epilepsy, a 2.6% increase compared to 1.3% of the control group. I know it sounds scary, but if you look back closely at the percentages, it is not a huge increase in the risk to develop these disorders. But it adds up, and it's something healthcare providers should keep in the back of their minds with these delayed sequelae. Clinical trials to treat long COVID are underway, and as more research explains the mechanisms and origins of long COVID symptoms, the more chances scientists will have to develop more effective treatments. If you guys are interested in watching videos discussing specific long COVID symptoms, do let me know in the comments below, and I'll try my best to gather all the relevant information and make a video about it.